making art as a nomad means imagining other futures where those categories and ideas of nationalism and national identity are not so relevant and other worlds are possible. My name is Beatriz Cortez and I am an artist and I'm also a scholar. I am a professor of Central American literature and culture. I am originally from El Salvador. I am from San Salvador, the capital city, and I came to the United States in 1989 in the middle of the Civil War. My life as a scholar and my life as an artist is intertwined. I make art about the experience of immigration. I teach in the only Department of Central American Studies in the country. For me, the experience of being an immigrant and being a Central American immigrant in LA is also about the opportunity to deconstruct what national identity is in Central America. And here, I'm trying to understand not only the movement of Central American peoples and of all peoples, but also the transformation of identities, of genders, of ways of imagining the world and trying to imagine nomadism and imagining potential motions towards an unknown other. Making art as a nomad means then imagining other futures where those categories and ideas of nationalism and national identity are not so relevant and other worlds are possible outside not only of that small provincial space of liberalism, but also of the era of the humans, right? And so imagining other eras where humans are not is a way to dismantle also that humanism that's linked to liberalism and to the Enlightenment and to Eurocentric thinking and to see the world from other perspectives. And that's why for me it has been really important to think about, to pay attention to what not only indigenous contemporary scholars are saying, but also what ancient peoples said and what they left for us in some of their sacred books, and to think about how connected they are to speculative thinking. I do believe that it is important for me to construct spaces that people can enter and spaces that people can experience or that people can imagine themselves inside the space. I was fascinated by the designs that Buckminster Fuller had made, but at the same time, I was not happy about the fact that he had a patent to structures that I had seen in other places. Indigenous forms of construction are also built in the same way. And for me, it was important to question that. And I try to think many ways of doing that. And one way was to think of a space in El Salvador that had constructions that were built in based on geometries and to bring it into conversation with the designs that Buckminster Fuller had made. All that was complicated by Drop City and the histories around Drop City. I was fascinated by the idea that they were claiming to be nomads. They were claiming to live on the outside, on the exterior of capitalism. But in order to do that, they had gathered funds and they had gone to Trinidad and they had bought land and they had created an exterior that was founded on private property and land ownership. And I read about this guy, Peter Rabbit, who was an anthropologist that infiltrated, in many ways infiltrated their commune. He basically passed as one of them, but was really studying them and writing a book about them. But Peter Rabbit had also these ideas that he wanted to create a festival called Joy Fest. And so I was calling it Joy Station, on the one hand thinking of my own interest in the work of Spinoza and his ideas about joy as an ethics of existence, and at the same Peter Rabbit creating Joy Fest that brought so many people to drop city, and that created many problems. And so I built Trinidad Joy Station thinking about those things and trying to imagine a future of diversity. And when I was thinking about the spaces in Trinidad Joy Station, which is the private space, which is the public space, I was playing with that, the gardens that had ancient indigenous plants from the Americas. And there was a space in the corner where I had placed a series of beds made of chain link and mylar ribbons that were an homage to the children in detention centers that had those same materials in their experience being incarcerated and separated from their families, but that you know, I was trying to use the same materials to imagine that another world is possible, a world where if you bounce the light, if you weave petates with the mylar ribbons, if you bounce the light in certain ways, you can build a cosmos. Noma 13 is a collaboration with Rafa Esparza, where Rafa and I were thinking a lot about a spaceship that would nurture the humans of the future, that would be in space, in orbit, with a garden, and that would allow the humans of the future to survive. For us, a garden included spiritual qualities and labor. And so we wanted to inscribe the labor onto the pieces that we make. And so in his case, making the adobe bricks as part of the practice that he inherited from his father, Ramon Esparza. And in my case, making the space capsules and leaving very visible all the marks of our labor, it was a way to shift away from this slick, futuristic ownership of the future, but rather making the future be of laborers, of workers, and of indigenous peoples. When I moved to San Fernando, my next door neighbor had a house that was made by an indigenous Apache Mescalero builder by the name of Dan Montelongo. What I was fascinated by is that through my immigrant eyes, because I had been to so many pyramids in the Americas and I had seen so many forms of indigenous construction, I could immediately tell that these were forms of indigenous construction, but the fact that they were called LA vernacular style of architecture erased that. So I began to make different pieces. For example, I made the fireplace in my house in the style that Dan Montelongo might have done it, but I made the rocks with steel. That show was called LA vernacular space capsule interior. And I was imagining a space capsule interior made by him. I also decided to replicate the porch of the house, my next door neighbor's house. And that piece is called De La Cora Porch, a time traveler. And I was imagining De La Cora Porch because Dan Montelongo was making these houses that are on Brand Boulevard, you know, this main area, this main boulevard in San Fernando, for wealthy patrons that could afford them. So I was interested in the fact that my next door neighbor was a Lakota woman and that Dan Montelongo was an Apache Mescalero man, but that many, many people had to inhabit this house before she could have it. And that in the period of 100 years, an indigenous builder had built a house for an indigenous woman. Glacial Erratic was inspired by the glacial erratic boulders that are all over the landscape in New York City. These rocks were moved by the planet in like 18 million years ago, millions of years ago, when the Laurentine ice cover that was covering the area began to melt and move them. So what happens with glacial erratics is that they have different mineral content to the landscape around them. And so these rocks then are foreigners to the landscape that they occupy. So I was interested in thinking about these rocks as a way to imagine migration as natural, as planetary, as millenary, and also to invite people to imagine the impact of the atmosphere on matter. The sculpture is changing color and turning into a brown mass when it was this shiny silver, almost armor looking sculpture. So I'm interested in the metaphor that it creates of the passing of time and the multiple temporalities that matter occupies. For me also, in terms of the construction of that work, I wanted to say that it was important to make it in a way that was the opposite of efficiency or modernity or industrialization. I made it with a team of people that were willing to work with the tools that are available and accessible to immigrants, with torches, with pliers, with hammers, with sacks of sand, with MIG welders, and with metal cutters. And we didn't use any other technologies or any forms of construction that were, you know, not linked to that. And that was really beautiful, made it really beautiful to see when groups of immigrants from my community came to work. They like swam like fish in the water because they knew how to use all these materials. All these tools were familiar to them. Everyone had an opinion about it, and it was quite an amazing experience for me to learn from all of them so much about what it means to work collectively.